On January the 12th, 2010, a massive earthquake hit Haiti, leaving over 200,000 people dead and thousands more with their lives destroyed. Today, more than 1 year on from the tragedy, and with millions of dollars in aid money promised, the situation in Haiti has not improved enough. Amidst the chaos of an earthquake, a cholera epidemic, and post-election riots, the volunteer has linked up with a small UK charity, the Haiti Hospital Appeal, to provide security, training, and a home to the much-needed volunteers of this charity. The volunteer will be refurbishing a building for doctors and nurses, building a security wall, and assisting in the training and distribution of water filters for the Haiti Hospital Appeal in Haiti's second largest city, called Cap Haitien. This challenging project hopes to inspire people to volunteer and highlight the good work of smaller UK charities, as well as the ongoing need for continued relief work in Haiti. This is The Volunteer.
Tu me vois? We're right out in the middle of nowhere here, just outside Cap Haitien. I've been volunteering on this site for the last week. It's been pretty exhausting. I can't do more than my best. I hope that's going to be enough to help this charity and Haiti.
Very good evening. Our top story live at 5. Haiti's cry for help.
The main city of the poorest nation in the Western Hemisphere literally folded in on itself.
Covered in dust, dazed and frightened, two women just pulled from the basement of a youth hostel are treated on the road. The chances of finding others alive under rubble are shrinking.
Heaven knows how much devastation there is in the flimsy shanty towns beyond.
Where I was, everybody was killed. Only myself and another guy survived.
Up until yesterday, we heard voices. Last night, no one heard voices.
The thick smell of smoke, putrefaction, and sewage smothers the makeshift camps where the homeless have gathered. Bodies on the street are starting to rot.
They are getting stinky, and you know, there's a lot of disease.
But in this shaken city, these are the lucky ones. Many thousands lie buried in concrete graves.
They are desperate for just basic supplies, clean drinking water and food.
A cholera outbreak in the northwest of Haiti has started to spread.
It's claimed the source was a UN peacekeeping base in the town of Mirabale.
Our people are dying because we have sick people around. We need help. That's all we need.
Having been deeply shocked at the devastation of Haiti following the earthquake, Hugo has raised funds to support a project for the Haiti Hospital Appeal in Haiti. Hugo visits their offices in London to meet with their representatives and deliver the funding that he has raised for their chosen project.
When you go to Port-au-Prince, you'll just see chaos.
Yeah.
You think, hang about, well, how long ago was this earthquake? What we're doing on the ground is small in comparison to the size of the problem. Yeah. It is very dangerous.
They no longer believe promises that have been made.
Hugo arrives at Heathrow to begin his journey to Haiti. However, he is apprehensive after the recent media attention concerning the post-election riots.
We've got an amazing project with a great charity where we're getting fully involved in the cholera epidemic that's hit Haiti. Unfortunately, there is tension in terms of the politics. There's a recount of the election and it's going to cause upset. They'll probably be rioting, which could send our plans into turmoil.
Hugo will travel via Miami to Port-au-Prince, Haiti's capital city, and then up to Cap Haitien, Haiti's second largest city on Haiti's north coast. On arrival at Port-au-Prince Airport, Hugo goes out to find Billy, his fixer in Haiti, who will be organizing all the security and travel logistics for his stay. It soon becomes clear in the car park of the airport that things in Haiti are tense and chaotic, with police inquiring about the cameras and baggage handlers fighting over their luggage. In Port-au-Prince, Hugo travels to some of the worst affected zones.
was unbelievable. For me, it was worse than a war.
The evidence is still clear that nothing has been done, with hundreds of buildings destroyed, a mass of rubble still littering the city, and of a population of 3 million, at least 1 million of those still living in tents.
So this is where people live.
With the National Palace destroyed in the earthquake, it acts as the symbol of the destruction that Haiti has suffered. Outside the palace, Hugo meets Carlos, who leads him into the tent city to see what life is like and explains how angry the people are that aid has not reached them.
I live in this camp already. The government René Préval, he spent already $3 million for selling camping. We already lost 104 people in cholera in this camp. And we don't have no medical team still right now. We have no education, nothing. See how people live in bad condition, you know? 1 year. That's my sister. You already have the virus. How people live. When Michel Mate talk about education, we feel something. We feel this country can be one day, can be another country. That's Préval, that's the devils right here. We call them devils, you know? We don't need them in this country. Fuck you, Préval, sorry about that.
Later on that day, Hugo visits the largest tent city in Port-au-Prince, in Pétionville, housing some 55,000 people. This immense place, positioned on a golf course, has largely become self-sustainable, with market stalls, a school, and medical facilities put up inside.
This is the biggest tent city there is. Every night, people comes in and build their tents. They have nowhere to stay, nowhere to go. So they came here to try to find a way to reestablish their life. And it's kind of hard to have something that you work real hard for, and now you have to start back from scratch. You know what I mean?
We have studio.
Yes, it is. It is a city.
Tent city.
Yeah, tent city. Now we enter the market.
On his tour around, it is clear that people are doing their best to survive in the tent cities under very tough conditions, and that these places have become cities within a city.
I gotta look at my little shack. Daytime is hot. Nighttime is cold. Yeah, gotta be neat. You know, I'm a clean type of guy.
Hugo heads to the domestic airport, where he's able to talk further with Billy about the current tensions.
So you have got a bit of an agent against the UN.
Yeah.
Because the UN's being blamed for the cholera, and they don't see the UN as doing anything. You'll see some army people around here driving around, pointing guns at people, dressed as if they're in Iraq or Afghanistan. Yeah. People are desperate for help, you know, and they're not getting it.
We're now on a little hopper flight to Cap Haitien, where our project is happening. I don't know what we're going into, but I think it's going to be pretty interesting, whatever it is.
After a 20-minute flight, Hugo lands in Cap Haitien, where he's greeted by Jimmy, his driver, and Jean, his security guard. Also at the airport are Carwin and Johnny, the founders of the Haiti Hospital Appeal, who will follow Hugo back to his hotel for an initial discussion.
Great.
Give me some money, please. $20.
You are the boss.
Jean, can I give you that?
You are the boss?
No, I'm not the boss. Jean's the boss. Guys, let's all jump on board.
Cap Haitien is located on the north coast of Haiti and is the country's second largest city. This area of Haiti has largely been forgotten about, with little or no aid reaching those most in need.
It was like a big wave. Going like you go up, you go down, you go up and down, and then you shoot like that, bouncing both sides.
It's strange because I can't place Haiti. It's a massive unknown. What's going to happen next? Not just tomorrow, but you know, the next hour or minute.
and it's good that we've got our driver and our security man just here beside us, Jean.
Hugo heads to the village of Benediction, a project that he will be volunteering on for the coming week. The project will involve refurbishing a building for volunteer doctors and nurses, the building of a security wall and gate around the property to secure it, and the distribution of water filters to cholera-affected zones in the rural countryside.
This is where we find out exactly what is going on here on the ground with this charity and what's in store for us for the week.
With work having already commenced prior to his arrival, Hugo is delighted to see that the project might be achievable within the target of 1 week. Hugo also gets a tour of the charity's facilities and begins to meet the people he will be working with. The Haiti Hospital Appeal is made up of a much-needed medical clinic that delivers free medical care to those most in need. It has a spinal rehabilitation centre that is now caring for victims who were paralysed in Haiti's earthquake.
Bassan pile misère avant nous jeune médecin c'est juste sous 4 jours une jeune médecin parce que actuellement moi même tant que là j'aimerais me toujours gagner espoir m'a marcher quand même.
A cholera outreach program following the recent epidemic, and it has a children's respite home looking after disabled children. Hugo wakes up early and travels to the project for his first day of volunteering. He begins by meeting the workers and getting to know Frisbon, the head contractor who will be conducting the project build-out. It soon becomes clear that with no one speaking English, Hugo will be speaking in French to communicate with those he's working with. Hugo begins by working on the different elements involved in the construction of the security wall. He's put to work mixing the sand and cement, transporting it to the wall and learning how to construct the wall with rocks and boulders.
We're off to get some cement, in case you're wondering. This is how they transport the cement on the back of load pipes. Love it. Cement's from Santo Domingo. I'm starting to kind of get to know them and joke with them, which makes it so much easier. I just tried to cover each stage of the wall building process. It's so nice the way they let you join in, you know. Ah, c'est le chanteur. This is the singer. Let me show you just inside here. This is the house that we're refurbishing. It's going to have 3 bedrooms. Here's the bathroom. Most of the plumbing has been done. This will be another bedroom here. And they're doing the roof up there. You see them, they're putting the roof into action. This is the second bedroom. Probably sleep 2 or 4 volunteers. It's the electrician. And then this is the third bedroom in here. Put the roof up. But I mean, it's really making progress. The idea is that it looks exactly like that by the end of the week. At this rate, we're going to do it. This way. Bonjour, ça commence, hein? And that's the gate.
Hugo begins to break down the barriers with the workers, asking them about life in Haiti, how the project will help the community, and discussing which football team they support.
Pour avancer, il faut lire. These guys nail it in like 5 minutes. I'm getting blisters and getting in my eye and shit.
There are also the elder workers, who are busy clearing the whole site of shrubs, trees and plants using a simple machete. It is a tiresome process which they make look easy.
They're so cool, aren't they? Volunteering's not easy. Hey, Johnny. Morning. We're just going on a sand mission.
With sand needed to mix with the cement, Hugo heads off to collect a truckload of sand with one of the workers. They arrive at a river bordering the local town of Limonade, where sand is excavated from the riverbed by locals and then carried up steep riverbanks to be loaded onto trucks.
These guys dive in and get the sand from the river and then bring it up the banks, put it into piles, and then they load it onto the lorry to build our wall.
Hugo decides to give it a go and heads into the river to collect the sands needed for his truckload.
Jimmy, no laughing, mate. I mean it.
I told her you must go, you can't stay here. She said I know, since the death blow, my soul's been old like sand. I'm so tired, it's like my spirit expired. Remember when I was just a child, yeah? Now I feel like a star at daybreak about to expire and get lost in the sun. Me and you, we gotta leave and just run and run.
To the amusement of the spectating crowd, Hugo struggles to make it up the riverbank.
The nights are cold,
but finally manages to deliver the last few buckets of sand with the locals. The truck returns to the project where the sand is then deposited on site, ready for mixing. After a busy morning collecting sand, Hugo gets busy with the painting of the building.
A big part of the project, this refurbishing, and painting it is something else. Because you really feel as though you're doing something here, helping them, you know, and you're part of the team.
It's another UN helicopter taking off.
With the United Nations base next door to the project, helicopters are often taking off and landing, and with much controversy surrounding their role in Haiti, Hugo heads over to chat to some of the UN soldiers on duty. The presence of the UN in Haiti is apparent everywhere, with soldiers, tanks, and armored vehicles patrolling the streets. However, the local Haitians' relationship with them does not appear to be as good as one would expect. According to the local people, they have failed to deliver or help with the relief work following the earthquake. And worse still, the cholera epidemic is believed to have evolved from the Nepalese UN headquarters that is based in Haiti. The cholera epidemic in this part of Haiti has been particularly bad, with thousands having already died and many more affected. The Haiti Hospital Appeal has linked up with Médecins Sans Frontières to put up an emergency cholera tent and treatment program. Hugo visits the tent and meets the main doctor, Mike, who explains the severity of the situation and how it is treated.
The cholera is a sickness that gives people severe diarrhea and vomiting, so severe that they can die within 12 hours without treatment. So when our patients first come, they're assessed by our triage nurses and our triage doctor, get a drip straight away, because they'll be very dehydrated. Once they're stabilised, we'll move them onto the ward. With access to healthcare, we can treat most of our patients very effectively. The rural areas are still being affected by cholera. Yeah, the access for those people isn't quite as good.
As Hugo is visiting the tent, a patient arrives by ambulance who needs urgent treatment if he's going to survive.
Symptoms of cholera are profuse, watery diarrhea.
Right.
He's emaciated and he has had breathing problems. It's possible he's got tuberculosis. All these things compound the effect of the cholera and make it harder for him to have a good recovery.
That was very intense.
With many Haitians unable to get to a medical facility, it is the poorer areas that have suffered the most. In Sharda slum, Hugo meets Madame Bois, who explains that the true number of how many people have died in the slum will never really be known.
550 people died of cholera at Eastie in Sharda. In Sharda.
That we didn't have anything to eat. If you feel me now, then sing. La 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 la. So good, so yeah. Good. Yeah.
We talk about this. Yeah.
La 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 la.
I'm a part of the ghetto.
Ghetto is a part of me.
Imamo la la wo.
Hugo travels to a cholera-affected rural village outside Cap Haitien.
Oh,
long hot walk up the mountain finally leads to a remote village full of people eagerly waiting to receive their water filters and education on cholera prevention.
Basically, we're just going to hang this up and we're going to go and get some water.
With work comfortably underway and progress being made, a lunch is organised and prepared for all the workers, followed by a competitive football match. After a busy day, it's time for Hugo to go and spend some time with the children of the charity. A recent donation from the US of buggies for the disabled gives Hugo a chance to connect with the children and put his DIY skills to use.
C'est bon.
Hugo heads to the market in downtown Cap Haitien to buy some materials needed for the new building and a mattress for himself.
Combien, madame? 70 bucks, man. Man, that shouldn't be even 50 bucks, should it?
The haggling in the marketplace seems to be made worse by the fact that being a white man, the prices seem to be more than in the UK.
Something colourful. Gotta be happy, hasn't it? Combien de mètres?
60. That'll
do our whole building. But once it rolled up, we're gonna take it and go and see Marie-Hélène and get her to work.
Hugo delivers the material to Marie-Hélène, who teaches him how to sew and make the curtains.
Pour acheter des matériaux. Tu veux regarder? Qui j'ai mouillé? Ah, voilà le crayon. Oui, la même distance.
Oui, oui.
Non, non, c'est bon. I can sew.
Yes.
Yes.
At the same time, Hugo hears Leon's story, who, having been pulled out of the rubble after the earthquake, found out that he'd lost all 8 of his children and his wife. Still suffering from the trauma, Leon opens up to Hugo about that fateful day, his recovery, and what life has been like since.
Vous perdez madame, vous perdez petit tout. C'est un coup, c'est pas un avant, vous connaissez, c'est arrière.
Back at the site, Hugo assists with the painting and laying of the roof. The these tin sheets that are put down by the workers are very sharp, and towards the end of the day, one of the workers cuts his hand badly. At the end of the day, Hugo spends his first night on site.
I've been finding it quite tough because I've been working really hard and I'm having to look after my team who are out here. I've also been struggling with my emotions. I'm very good at holding them back. But when I'm on my own, like now, everything comes home and I think about my family and I think about this charity. It's been really testing and I'm already tired in the evenings after all the work. And I do feel a little bit isolated. Just see, that's Sean, that's my bodyguard. And he's well armed, as you can see. I have to have a bodyguard here because there have been some kidnappings. Jean is going to be sleeping there, and I am going to be sleeping there. And I've just heard that Jean has actually spent quite a lot of time in prison recently, and I hope that that is not a bad thing. But anyway, we'll have to wait and see. Waking up, birds are singing, lights coming in, it's about 6 a.m. in the morning.
Being a Sunday, Hugo goes to church. Religion is an important cornerstone of life in Haiti, giving people strength, hope, and guidance at a difficult and testing time. With a large proportion of the population practicing Christianity during the day, there's also a large following of voodoo at night, which often involves rituals, baptisms, animal sacrifice, and magic potions. Back at the site, as the scramble for the opening ceremony takes place, it is soon clear that this is going to be a special occasion where all the hard work has come together and where Hugo has been accepted as part of the team.
C'est super, Marielle.
Je want j'ai maman oué.
Leon has been chosen to cut the ribbon, and Hugo is tired and emotional as the completed project comes to a close.
Sak passe. Naboule. Muerele Hugo. Mue soti Angleterre. Io vin ici per lavorare. Ok. Men appel chai palu. Chai palu. Sans cet homme, ça serait pas possible. Ce qu'on a fait dans une semaine seulement. Alors il faut applaudir à Pitman. Ok, go.
This really represents what the Haiti Hospital Appeal is about, what this last week has been.
For the anniversary of the earthquake, Hugo travels to Port-au-Prince. With celebration, mourning, and anger filling the streets. The anniversary is a day of mixed emotions.
nga bitin bato wa
Habitan bato wa ta bwi vinye de nou
Vinye de nou
Nou la fon an mè kan an
Mè wè pe yi sa Un an apè trembleman de te ya A yi si rete pi mal ke jan te ya
Problem kontrol ou
Problem kontrol ou fè mè ou pa ka bote Pa ka kon vini se mwen son pa Mè
ou se kanon pou ba basyon mwen nan film
Pa tout bagay paske a jezi la jan pou biye
Capitaine Batoa,
Capitaine Batoa, t'as pu vivre de nous.
One year.
La mer dans notre double chaviré. Oui, la mer a forcé nous plonger la périne. Après Jésus, Jésus, vivre de nous.
With the mood and impact of the earthquake still being felt 1 year on by those affected, it is hard to comprehend how so little has been achieved to help this devastated country. Yet the Haitian smiles and prayers on this sensitive day mirror a hope that their time will come. After the celebrations at the National Palace, Hugo revisits the tent city and meets one of the earthquake survivors, and hears her story.
How many relatives did she lose?
Five.
Was she buried in the earthquake?
Yeah, for 4 days.
She was under the rubble for 4 days. That's her mum.
See the hand?
Yeah, that's her.
That's her, yeah.
They all in the same building
same
together.
Same building, you know.
So you.
She survived in that hole.
Pulled her out of that hole.
I live in the close to her. I know that story with her.
And has she got family that left? Has she got?
Only her. Just as she have just like two little daughters.
Two little daughters.
Yeah.
And she lives here with them.
Yeah, she lives with them.
Let's go back to Bashiram Bukit Flemang.
So it's a desperate situation, isn't it?
Yeah, that's really hard, you know. Five sisters, you know, and her mom doesn't seven people, you know. Nobody have hope.
A year on from the disaster,
yeah.
People still seriously affected.
Yeah.
This emotional encounter typifies the pain and suffering felt by so many of those affected, and the helplessness that they still feel to restore dignity to their lives. The Catholic Cathedral was another landmark in the centre of Port-au-Prince that collapsed during the earthquake. Hugo is taken inside by Carlos to witness firsthand the devastation.
There are still many bodies left under this Catholic church, and no one knows the number, but Carlos says about 500 people, mostly children, were actually in this church when it collapsed. And that Carlos actually pulled out.
Me and my group, for 325.
And do you think the people underneath will ever?
But let me tell you something, man. You can see that right here. Many, many bodies still buried. At that time, we just can't even go inside, you know?
Yeah.
We take many bodies. But the government said more than 500, but we know that we know more than 3,000, you know?
Yeah.
Because it was a big church. The people was inside, no survivor. Can you see? Are we going to just go for the people, you know? See right now the people sit there.
As Hugo leaves the church to walk down Rue de Miracle, there is a sudden explosion as an angry group of protesters set light to a UN vehicle. Although the day has been largely peaceful, this demonstration of violence highlights the underlying feeling of frustration and anger that many Haitians feel at being neglected and largely forgotten by the international community, despite promises of huge sums of aid.
We have been criticized. It's true that 1 year after the earthquake, we still have 800,000 people in camps, but it's like half of the initial peak of 1.5 million. So we have made progress in a lot of areas, and the nutritional status of children has increased. But it's true that Haitians are frustrated. We should have done a better job at talking to them, explaining what they could expect after such a disaster.
We've reached the end of our journey here in Haiti. It's been tiring, it's been emotional, and it's been tense, but we've really seen the impact of the earthquake here in Port-au-Prince, and it's been a massive learning curve. Smaller charities, NGOs, they're the ones who are doing the real work here in Haiti. Charities like that are the ones who are moving mountains, literally. and we've seen earthquake victims suffering still in tent cities. This whole experience has reinforced my passion and dream to inspire people into the benefits of volunteering. Volunteers have so much to offer and so much that they can do in places like this. Haiti is a really interesting place. It's got a magic, and we're going to take that back home with us.
Everybody hurts sometimes. Sometimes everything is wrong.
I told her you must go, you can't stay here. She said I know, since the death blow, my soul's been old like sand. I'm so tired, it's like my spirit expired. Remember when I was just a child, yeah. Now I feel like a star at daybreak about to expire and get lost in the sun. Me and you, we gotta leave and just run and run. Remember when I was just a child, yeah. Now I feel like a star at daybreak about to expire and get lost in the sun. Me and you, we gotta leave and just run and run. Run and run.
Until my heart is burned.
What? Napoli!